Okay. You can hear me now. I think it might be a little too loud here, Giorgio. Welcome back. And I don't know about you, but I really think that it was very exciting to hear about Rory's history and about his thoughts both about Biblio, but also about how to make a business. And of course, we are quite proud that ever since he is a former Timo student, that this is one of the results of what this course can lead to. But that's just me personal. One practical issue: remember to sign up for the oral exam. You cannot enter the oral exam unless you send an email to our secretary and sign up for a day, if you have a special preference on which day you would like to go for the oral exam. But otherwise, you have to, even though you're indifferent on which day, you also have to sign up. So that's very important you do that, all of you, and the deadline is coming up rather soon, by the end of, almost the end of this month. Okay, so that was just a practical message. Then, now you have been through the business model canvas part of the curriculum. So you are supposed to be experts in that area, or going to be soon experts in it. And I just want to wrap up a little. I think, just to finish off on the first part of the talk show, that we went quite deep into the different aspects of the business model canvas, at least. But I think taking this business model generation and this way of thinking is what I would like to focus on now, so that you sort of get a summary of the first part of the curriculum. Okay? And it will be quite quick, because I still intend that we will finish in about 10-15 minutes. So developing a business model is what has been the focus in the business model generation. And I guess you have looked thoroughly into this canvas. And one way of using it is, of course, as you heard Rora talking, what is the value proposition? How do we connect this, the right side, you could say, which is related to the customers, and which, in the case of Biblio, you could hear was said, Rora said was, well, our customer segments, that is teachers, curious people, could also be a customer segment, but it wasn't really precise enough, so it was about learning that part of the users more thoroughly. Also, they said it was not for kids. So you can also, by looking into who is your customers, defining who is not our customers. So who is not part of the target group. That was also one of what he was saying. So he was mainly, when you say curious people, people over 16, he said, as one example. I would say he was also looking more thoroughly into what are our customer relationships, our channels, that is of course the internet and a lot of the different the platform and the internet. Key partners was also quite essential in the Biblio business model, where you had all these different providers of teaching and learning content. You have universities, museums, so both providers on the internet, but also in the more physical world. Then we had a discussion on these streams down here. What is actually the cost structure, and what is also the revenue stream, and how can it develop? Because as he was saying today, we don't really have any revenues. Of course, we can. They, as a company, they cannot continue like that. So they were already now thinking on short-term revenues and long-term revenues, and which kind of actions could be taken in order to create revenue streams for the future. So I think one point that you can take from this is that you don't just have a canvas either when you're doing analysis from the beginning, or when you are creating or planning for your startup, if that's what you're going to use it for. that you're not really having all the data for all the nine blocks from the beginning. It's an ongoing process that you sort of look into and then you elaborate on it. It's the same when you're doing the analysis. You have a starting point and then you elaborate from that one. Okay? And when you are doing the analysis, if you can use this to actually map what is the situation in the company, I saw that some of you were actually doing that already last Wednesday when you were working with the Milkfuss case to see what is the value proposition here. What is the customer segment? What is the key activities, key partners? How is the revenue streams and cost structure look? What does it look like? And how can it be developed if you take this opportunity of going into another market? Okay, so there you then some of you were already also thinking about, well, saying there's something that is as now, and then there was a future situation if you go into a business development. So you can use it to see, to map the situation. And of course, depending on what is the situation in the company, you can also see if there's actually some problems arising from this mapping. That there is actually a contradiction. We have these kind of customer segments. We have a value proposition that is not fitted with these customers or could be further or more tight fitted. Maybe even you have a new customer segment arising that you could develop your value proposition for. And also, in order to stay in the market, you might have to elaborate on your left side, searching for other partners in order to get a better grip on the market and get a tighter connection with your customers to strengthen your value proposition also. It could also be that you should actually develop or be more efficient in the way that you perform your key activities. Do we need to be better in our key resources? So you can also see doing this mapping can actually also show some problems in the current business model that could be elaborated. So it actually has different purposes, both as mapping and looking into what could be problems, but it can also be a development tool for heading the direction for where you want to go in a future situation when we're talking about analysis. And then, of course, if you are the one doing a business model canvas for your own company or a startup, you can also map these things into it. That was the canvas. Another thing that you can also say that is important in the when working with the business model canvas and business model generation is to take a further look at the value proposition and the users. Because even though all nine building blocks are important to perform a full canvas, you could say that it is important to put more focus on some of the elements. And of course, if you don't have a value proposition that is offering your customers or meeting their needs, then what is actually the purpose in the end? You might have a very efficient organization, but if you are not high on effectiveness, that you don't have the right goals, which is also equivalent to what is the value proposition, then it's going to be a tough business in the end. So this is another smaller, you could say, canvas, looking into who are the customers, getting to know what are, here they call it customer jobs, it means what is actually, what do the customers want to do. If it's you want to learn, you have to get the books, you have to read them, you have to acquire the knowledge somehow. We try to provide it in different ways, either by giving you a reading sample. We say, here's the timetable for the course. We have the Teamo Universe. That's our way of meeting your jobs in order to learn the Teamo course. Then you might experience some pains, that's why, and also some gains. That's why we ask you to give us feedback so we can actually relieve your pains and enhance the gains. Just to be in this, to continue in this language. But if you want to get to know your customers, these are the areas that you could look into. And in the book, you will have a lot of questions that is actually guiding you into learning more about the customers. And use these insights to actually improve or get a security for what your value proposition is today. Is it good enough? Is it, how can it be better? How are the competitors' value proposition today, and will they be a threat? Can they actually create more gains than your value proposition, or relieve pains, existing pains, in a better way? That's going to be a competitor's or the way that you can compete with others. And then you have this one. Now we zoom out, you can say, in the canvas. And this is describing the relationship between the business model and the environment, the business environment, the market. And here you have different areas to look into. One is key trends. This is where I would say that you might have a very strong asset, because you know about technology, you know where technology is heading, you understand the technology, and you can even see where it could be heading and also engage in that development. And technology, as we have seen for quite many years, can be quite disruptive for existing businesses. So there's it's really an area that's worth paying attention to, both to understand what could be the threats and opportunities in this area, but also to actually drive the development here. It's not only technology, it can also be regulatory trends. Do we have new laws on the way? That could be either a threat or an opportunity. Social and economic trends, social and cultural trends. What is our norms in society for what is considered appropriate or not? That's also influential on your business. Then you have these market forces, which is about needs and demands, market segments. Do we have new segments coming up, segments disappearing that can affect our business? You have this one called industry forces. This is also known as the Porter's Five Forces, as a very, very well-known framework within strategy. And this is actually about, do we have, what other suppliers do we have in the market? What is their power towards you? Do you have a good negotiation power towards them or not? So you will either obey or they must obey. To speak very black and white, do you have, what kind of stakeholders, competitors, what is the relationship to them? New entrants, is it in a market that is easier to come into or not? Do you need a lot of knowledge? Do you need a lot of equipment to be established? Then if you are already in the market, you can sort of say there is a lot of gates for the others to overcome until they can come in, or is this just about being one person and a laptop, and then you're actually going? Then you can think it must be quite easy to enter this market. And what other substitute products and services do we have in this market that can be either a threat or an opportunity for us? So these are the environmental areas to look into when you are to see what is then the fit between your business model and the environment. Because of course you can have, again, a very good value proposition also and made a very nice canvas, but if it's not fitted to the market that it's going to operate in, then it's not worth it anyway. And just to see these in connection, this is actually the new book coming out from the team that has written Business Model Generation. It should be coming out, I think, in a month or so. But here you can see that these three models are sort of connected, that if you have the canvas in the middle, you can zoom in and take a closer look at your customers and how it's fitted with your value proposition, or you can zoom out and see how your business model is connected with your environment. And actually you have to do both processes to get a full robustness check, you could actually say, on your business model. Good. to see why should we change a business model or not. It could always be fun to do changes, but it will also be quite costly to do it. So actually, you could say that we have four objectives, and one would be to satisfy existing or unanswered market needs. That's actually a new market that could be opening up here. It could also be to bring new technologies, products or service to the market. That is also to sort of embrace, you could say, a new unmet market or market demand. Improve, disrupt or transform an existing market. In many ways, you could say that's what Apple have done with their technologies. It might not be the best technology, phone technology. You have other competitors who actually, if you only look at the technology, do better. But they have integrated this into a network, and they have actually out-competed a lot of other players. One of them was Nokia, as you all know. That was actually quite a strong player within mobile phone market, and they didn't go in to this smartphone market, which really accelerated when you can say Apple launched its iPhone, and now you don't really see Nokia anymore in that area as a big player, at least. So that's also a way to develop or change a business model. Or it could be to create an entirely new market. And that could be what is called a blue ocean strategy. That's where you're creating a new market. You actually try to get out of the red ocean where you have a lot of competitors and a lot of where you have to really be good at your efficiency all the time. And actually try to get a monopoly for at least a moment until other entrants will also go into that market. But of course, a lot of risk is also connected to it because there might not be a market before you have competitors. And different motivations for changing. You can be either reactive, adaptive, expansive or proactive, and that's actually to all the changes that can happen in the environment on the model that I showed you before. That how do you actually respond to these changes? That could be your motivation for still staying in the market. And then you have different strategies to go for when you're changing a business model. One is low cost or differentiation, and just quickly explained, because it's actually set here. But you could go for the low cost, and that's actually where you are really being very, very focused on your efficiency. You produce at a low price with the real good use of your resources, all relative to what your competitors are doing, of course. Or you can differentiate and say, well, we will do something else than our competitors are doing. And then you have discussions, can you actually do both? And some would say, no, that's not a good idea. You have to either be focused on using your resources efficiently, or that you should go for having a better effectiveness on your way of targeting market. And others would say you can actually do both. But that's a discussion between theorists. This one is also another type of strategy that you can look into, and it's not really very user-friendly to write with white here, but you can say this one is the three types of businesses that you have: customer relationship management, the product innovation, infrastructure management. And you could see all three coexist in a company, and very often they would do. But you could also say that they should be unbundled into separate companies or at least separate sections so that you can optimize on the different ways of doing business. Because as you can see here, they are all reflecting different key activities, key drivers and key business processes. So in order to actually specialize within them, it can be a good idea to unbundle. And I would say in the book it's mainly said to unbundle into separate companies, but you would also see a lot of companies actually having it under the same roof, but into separate units in the organization. Yeah. Do you have any questions in relation to this? I would say these are more thoughts that you can think about when you are to suggest solutions for the casework and the case analysis. Of course, they can also contribute to your problem understanding in the cases. So this is just a quick run through. And then you have these different business patterns. That's also part of developing the business model. You could continue in the existing one, but also think of, do we have other ways of doing things? And you might recognize some of these pictures, or at least what they are supposed to be. This is the long tail, where you, instead of going for one customer segment with one product, you actually target a lot of different segments with very specialized products. This is what you see, especially within the media business, where you used to have one or two main TV stations, and today you have a bunch of specialized TV stations. You had a couple of few big newspapers, and today you have they're having a hard time, and now you have a lot of specialized magazines or newspapers. So this is actually to make a business of going from this situation and into this one, where you might have a smaller amount of customers, but having different products, you can actually still have a lot of customers in a whole. Yes, and this one with the unbundling is also a kind of business pattern. This one with the freemium is actually that you're, yeah, just has free as a business model, where you give things away for free. In the long run, they are probably not for free, but somebody else is paying for them, like you have with newspapers on the internet. Many sites are free, but they are then paid by advertisers that are buying, yeah, ads on the site. This one is actually what Roar was talking about, the platform as a business model, where you have your asset is a platform, and then you make it possible for different customer segments to meet. So you will typically have two different customer segments. One would be curious users as you, in the case of Biblio, and then you, on the other hand, would have universities, museums, others, content providers, and your way of making money is then that either people are paying for using the platform or getting access to it, or that people could pay for getting access to you. This is also how, when you were making auctions, auction sites or dating sites and so on, it's the same type of business model pattern. And then you have this one where you have open innovation, either people or companies doing a lot of research, but they cannot really put it into practice. So they sell these patents or their knowledge to people who can actually put it into practice, or you will have it as a strategy of a company saying, we don't have, we cannot afford having an expensive research and development department, so we will buy these things or this kind of knowledge and then put it into a product or service. So they kind of exchange and make an asset out of what either they have as knowledge or what is their competence. Think of these as some sort of patterns or archetypes, so you can think of what is the dynamic in this way of thinking about making a business, and maybe it could also be applied to some of your solutions in the cases. Let me just see here. And then we have this one. This is actually what is in focus for the next couple of weeks, the STAR model. And the STAR model is about linking your strategy or your business model to the organization. Because one thing is that we have smart people finding out what kind of business do we have here, what would be interesting for the users, how can we set this up, how can we make a nice business pattern that we can, or nice way of doing business, but we also need to have the organization in place to actually provide this kind of knowledge. And there you have the structure, how do we divide our work, which kind of roles and relationships do we have? What kind of work processes, for instance, or other processes in the organization? How should we motivate? And also the people practices. So now we will return to some of the first issues that we started out with, like the four functions of management and so on. But that's all what's on for the next couple of weeks. Okay? Good. Then if you don't have any questions, I just to say thank you for all your engagement today and have fun this afternoon with soft performance.